Our dear viewers, and welcome to a new edition of our program, Africa Today. In today's edition, we are going to talk about President Abdel Fattah al-Sisi's speech celebrating the occasion of Prophet Muhammad's birth, peace be upon him. But first, we'll take this report about the Muslim countries which are celebrating the Prophet Muhammad's birth anniversary every year. But celebrations vary from one country to another according to their traditions and their culture. More details.
The Prophet Muhammad's birth anniversary celebrations are not part of religion or religious teachings, but rather a public show of remembrance and a chance to review the Prophet's teachings. And though the exact date is not definitively recorded, the event is widely agreed to be celebrated on the 12th of Rabi' al-Awwal, the third month in the lunar calendar. In Egypt, the traditions which we know today were first introduced during the Fatimid era. Before then, celebrations involved readings of the Quran only. Since Fatimid rule, public squares have been decorated, tents have been set up for Sufi singing, and special Maulid suites have been made. Since the day is recognized as a national holiday in most of the Muslim-majority countries of the world, it is popular with family gatherings and greetings.
Celebrating this very special occasion, His Excellency President Abdel Fattah al-Sisi witnessed a very important celebration which was organized by the Endowment Ministry at the Manara Conference Center in the Fifth Settlement. The celebration was attended by Prime Minister Mustafa Madbouli, Al-Azhar Grand Imam Dr. Ahmed Al-Tayyib, Mufti of the Egyptian Republic Shawi Al-Lam, Endowment Minister Mohammed Mukhtar Gumaa, number of ministers and senior officials. During the celebration, the President delivered a speech on this occasion where he asserted that the celebration of the occasion call on all the meaning of mercy in our religion. He added that Islam is based on construction principles, not destruction. Al-Sisi said that correcting the misconception of Islam topped the state's priority. The President stressed on the significance of integrating all the efforts of the religious, educational and media institutions to build a moderate character capable of facing the actual challenges. The President also honored a number of religious scholars. For his part, Al-Tayyib called the international society to legislate against discrimination and insulting religions. Al-Tayyib condemned the offense against our Prophet, especially when it came from countries claiming that they have culture and civilization. To shed more light on that occasion and President Abdel Fattah al-Sisi's speech, we are very much delighted to have with us over the phone His Excellency Ambassador Gamal Bayoumi, former Assistant Foreign Minister. Ambassador Bayoumi, good afternoon to you.
Good afternoon, how are you?
Ambassador Bayoumi, during his speech, His Excellency President Sisi asserted that Islam is based on construction principles and not destruction. How do you see this very important point which the President is highlighting concerning Islam?
It is a speech of tolerance and wisdom.
Indeed.
And it shows that we are quite sure about ourselves and our religion and our Prophet. Mm. We do not quarrel with those who are insulting us or talking badly about our religion. Mm. And I am deeply involved in this process since long time, when we started the Euro-Arab dialogue. Hmm. And then Minister of Foreign Affairs of Sweden, Anna Linde, she started this initiative of a dialogue among religions. Hmm. And I answered her, we were in Malta 15 years ago or more, that hmm. In such a dialogue, I am deeply in a very good position, because I cannot be a Muslim. Yes. Unless I recognize and respect and
Indeed.
Believe in oh. Christianity and Judaism.
Indeed.
Because we respect all our prophets, whether it is Mosiah or Jesus Christ.
Mm.
But you have a problem because you do not recognize
of
our
course.
Religion or our prophet.
Yes.
So since then we established in Alexandria the center for a dialogue among civilizations. We have to continue this because it's really our duty
mm.
to get in a sort of a positive dialogue in order to show other people and other cultures that each place in the world has its own culture.
Mm.
And sometimes they exaggerate about those things and about human rights and about the freedom of expression.
Indeed.
Freedom of expression is a sort of something which sometimes it is well used and sometimes it's badly used in Europe, even in France.
Yes.
You cannot, if you even making a sort of economic report or political report, you cannot ask the number of those Jewish victims in the Second World War.
Yes.
This will put you under a severe load there. But you can threat or insult other religions without a problem. But maybe I must tell you and the audience that once I was lecturing in Europe and a gentleman from
yes.
Sweden came to me, he said, those who are insulting Islam or the prophet of Islam,
yes.
they are not Christians, by the way.
Indeed.
They are non-religious people, and
Indeed.
They are insulting all the religions and all the prophets. So, but we have to follow them and to stop them from doing this,
of
annoying people and insulting people. And here it comes,
Indeed.
The speech of the president, also the speech of the Grand Imam of Al-Azhar, and really, both of them were very practical concerning how we face yes. such an attack against us. Mm-hmm. It's not a matter of revision or something like that, but it is a process to find fact.
Mm.
And I am happy with the initiatives of Imam also to establish a page of Al-Azhar where we can put all the realities yes. about Islam and other cultures and other religions, and mm-hmm. also to make a prize for the best experience about Islam and the best experience about other religions an annual process.
Yes, indeed.
This will conduct us to a much more stable situation between all the cultures in the whole world.
Indeed. Mr. Bayoumi, that would bring me to ask also about a very important point which was highlighted by His Excellency President Sisi, which is the importance of correcting the misconception of Islam, which is one of the top priority of the states for the moment.
This is our duty, by the way, and we have to train our people abroad and even our children in the schools how to be tolerant, how to be very calm whenever they are asked about this question or that. And not to be involved in a bad discussion or something like that. It is our duty on the level of schools, on the level of our training institutions, and on our mass media also, to explain to our people how to react whenever we are attacked and not to be nervous or badly answering those attacks.
Also, the president stressed on the significance of integrating all the efforts of the religious, educational, media institutions to build a moderate character which is capable of facing the actual challenges. How to build a moderate character from your point of view, Mr. Ambassador, away from all extremism and extremist ideologies which we have been witnessing, which many people were trying to implant in our new generation?
It is very important, and it takes a huge effort on all levels, in the schools, in our mass media, in our discussions, a sort of conferences to
yes.
have a good dialogue among civilizations. And we have to make people understand that
yes.
if you want to respect your civilization and your habits, you have to respect our civilization also.
Of course.
And as Muslims, we are in a better situation, as I explained before, because we believe in God, we believe in all the prophets, we believe in all religions, so we do not have this difficulty. So we have to continue this process, and it's not easy, by the way.
Of course.
And but the good advice I would take, that to be very calm and to be very receptive to whatever the question addressing to you.
Yes.
Here, it is a sort of a habit. We have to learn how to make good discussions here and to make a calm discussion without provoking the others.
Yes. Ambassador, to what extent you have seen an importance in the statement by, of course, the Grand Imam of Al-Azhar, Ahmad Al-Tayyib, calling on the international society to legislate against discrimination and insulting religions, which is a very important point that it should be tackled on the international arenas, not only in Egypt, Mr. Ambassador?
It is everywhere we know insulting religions and culture is not allowed. And in Egypt, we have this law which stops any person to insult religions or cultures. So we hope that the whole world accept this, not by laws, because really it's not a matter of law. It's a matter of respecting the other and to recognize the right of everybody to have his own beliefs. But it is, after all, a culture much more than it is a need of a law. But if we need a law, we have to establish a law to face the situation.
Indeed. Ambassador Jamal Bayoumi, former Assistant Foreign Minister, always a pleasure to listen to your precious input, Mr. Ambassador, and say, have a very happy occasion, of course, of Prophet Muhammad's birth, which is of great importance to all the Muslim community and the Muslim world. And moving on to Sudan, where Sudan's head of the Sovereign Council, General Abdel Fattah al-Burhan, visited Egypt on Tuesday. President al-Sisi received of course, welcomed the visiting guest. The visit came while trilateral talks between Cairo, Khartoum, and Addis Ababa over the disputed Ethiopian dam resumed.
El-Sisi and Chairman of Sudan's Sovereign Council, Abdel Fattah al-Burhan, stressed their adherence to a binding deal over the filling and operation of the disputed Grand Ethiopian Renaissance Dam. El-Sisi held a meeting with al-Burhan, who arrived earlier on Tuesday in Cairo for a one-day visit. El-Sisi spokesman Bassam Radi said the meeting saw discussions over the Grand Dam, with a consensus reached over the water issue facing both sides, deeming it a national security issue. El-Sisi affirmed support for the political leadership in Sudan in shaping their country's future, welcoming all efforts aiming to aid Sudan in facing its economic crisis and towards accomplishing regional stability and peace. El-Burhan praised efforts to bolster mutual cooperation between Cairo and Khartoum. The visit came hours before the resumption of trilateral talks between Cairo, Khartoum, and Addis Ababa, proposed by the African Union chairman over the dam.
And France and Mali had a difference of opinion on Monday over whether the talks to rebels to help end the Sahel state 8-year-old insurgency. The French foreign minister is ruling the option out. More details.
France and Mali are differing over how to tackle the insurgency in the Sahel state. Mali's government is considering holding talks with the rebels to end the Sahel state's 8-year-old insurgency, with French Foreign Minister Jean-Yves Le Drian ruling the option out. During a news conference in the capital Bamako, the French minister distinguished between engaging with armed groups which had signed peace accords and what he termed terror groups. His visit marks the first by a French politician since young army officers toppled President Ibrahim Boubacar Keïta on August 18. After international pressure, Mali's military junta handed over to an interim government, which is meant to stage elections within 18 months. Le Drian said his position was shared by the United Nations Security Council and the G5 Sahel countries. But in a sign of policy rift, Mali's interim leader disagreed with the French official. Mokhtar Weini, Mali's interim prime minister, said the conclusions of the inclusive national dialogue that took place in the country very clearly indicated the need for an offer of dialogue with armed groups.
Well, with that, our dear viewers, we come to the end of our edition of Africa Today. Thank you very much for watching, and have a very blessed occasion of Prophet Muhammad's birth anniversary. May God bless all our dear viewers. Thank you very much for watching. That was Mahisi Rabia, brought to you live our program Africa Today from our studios here on ITV International. Thank you very much for watching.